The Pleiadian Mission, A Time of Awareness. Part 8. Economics. The Pleiadians have no economics as we know it, but do have a system of sharing the resources of their world. Each person is encouraged to develop to their full potential, and then bring those abilities into society. Material possessions are all provided, based on their contribution to the community. They carry no coins or credit cards. As a matter of fact, they mention that we have the only paper money that they have ever seen. They are in contact with many worlds, but have not found another planet as totally engrossed in the pursuit of money as we are. They even observe that we use economics as a weapon. We actually make war with economics, instead of simply using it as a method of keeping score. On a Pleiadian planet, all things are provided in their society, since achievement for the sake of material possessions leads to greed, hate, and anger, and that detracts from spiritual growth. Since most of the citizens are telepathic, it is not possible for them to deceive or mislead each other, and this provides for an environment of truth and honesty among all. Because of this, everyone is able to share in the resources of their world in accordance with their contribution, without the fear of greed and power. This has made their life more pleasurable, and creates an environment where the quality of life is considerably higher. Government. The Pleiadian civilization spent thousands of years at war, until they came across a race of highly developed beings in the Andromeda galaxy who were in the last stages of physical life. By the calendar here on Earth, this would have been around the year 10 AD. This race of beings was far more advanced than the Pleiadians, for they had lived many more lifetimes and accumulated almost total knowledge of the material existence and the logic of creation. A time had come for the Andromedans when they evolved beyond their physical senses, and consequently relied solely on their spiritual consciousness for daily interaction. A decision was made to take the advice of these advanced beings and to abide by their suggestions, which led to peace and the end of war. The Pleiadians now have a high council composed of the more spiritually advanced, who interpret the wisdom from the Andromeda beings and spread the information to all four of their planets. All citizens in the Pleiades take part in the decisions that are made, which make the laws by which they live. This is done through a system of voting similar to ours, only it takes a very high percentage of the voting public to agree before anything is passed. In some cases, everyone must agree before a change is made. This is done to encourage a feeling of unity and peace, and to take into consideration the views of everyone before making changes. The Pleiadians are a member of an alliance of civilizations that take advice from the beings from Andromeda. This includes thousands of different societies scattered all over the Andromeda galaxy and our own Milky Way, creating a total population of about 127 billion people. Not all developed races belong to this alliance, but those who do adhere to certain rules governing civilizations such as ours. In the Pleiades, each planet governs itself in a unitary type system but is subordinate to the High Council, which is located on Era and is the central government. The Council is comprised of half-spiritual and half-material or semi-spiritual/semi-material creatures, which are human forms of life with enormous knowledge. It is the High Council's function to be in contact with very high pure spiritual forms for advice, which is impossible for pure material forms of life because the energy oscillations of the spiritual spheres arc too high for the average Pleiadian. They belong to an alliance, including races from a neighboring universe called the Dao Universe, which tries to regulate peace in certain areas of the universe through the use of giant spacecraft. The patrols that watch over Earth report that there are many space travelers who visit here. Each year around 3,000 ships enter our atmosphere, but only a small percentage are interested in making contact, and then it is usually only telepathic. As of 1976, the Pleiadians stated that were 7 other races besides themselves that maintain bases here on Earth. Alliance with Earth. We are told that the Pleiadians abide by rules that do not allow them to interfere in our political or power structures here on Earth, provided that we are confined to our own solar system. Once we have the technical ability to leave our solar system under our own power and move out into free space, then we will come in contact with other races, including the Pleiadians, who will try to influence us. They want to make it clear that we, the people of Earth, must be very careful to whom we align ourselves, for there are many races out there who are very barbaric and would take us over in a minute or destroy us altogether. They hope that we may choose to align ourselves with them and other peaceful races, but the time is rapidly approaching that we may have to defend ourselves from an attack from space, for Earth is very well known in this area of the galaxy. The Pleiadians afford us some measure of protection by making their presence known to incoming ships through a network that surrounds our planet, but it is not clear to what extent they would go to defend us from invasion. Occasionally, ships piloted by dangerous races come into Earth space and take humans for experiments. Love and marriage. Pleiadians fall in love, marry, create families, and raise children just as we do. Although nothing is known about the marriage ceremony, we have been told that multiple marriages are common. It is quite normal for Pleiadians to be involved in two or three marriages at the same time. This system seems to work quite well for them, due to an emotional stability in their society that has all but eliminated jealousy and possessiveness. Families will generally live on the same land but in different houses, while the responsibility for raising children is shared by all. Divorce is not allowed because they feel this is an offense against the laws of creation. If the marriage laws are broken, the partners are exiled from the planet, but this rarely happens. They believe in many kinds of love, especially in friendship and marriage, which are very closely related, as well as the love of all creatures. If the rare case happened that a Pleiadian chose to marry someone from another race less spiritually evolved than themselves, then it is provided that the spiritual evolution of the less evolved life form could be accelerated to meet the evolved level of the partner. This is done through a transplant of brain acids that contain the evolutionary wisdom of the higher evolved individual, which can be put into the lower evolved life form, causing a rapid increase in their development. Apparently, this process works quite well and becomes a permanent part of the evolution of the recipient life form. Landing on the White House lawn. There is no plan to land on the White House lawn. The Pleiadians have listened to the thoughts of most world leaders and believe that all earthly governments are only interested in power and control, and have little interest in anything else. An examination of the thoughts of our leaders shows them all to be power-crazy individuals who look at extraterrestrials as a source of power to conquer the cosmos when, in fact, they cannot even create peace on their own world. A possible meeting was once discussed with certain officials of the American government, and the Pleiadians agreed to meet with a small group. As the Pleiadians listened to the thoughts of the officials who were planning the meeting, it was discovered that the officials were planning to kill them at the meeting site so that they could obtain the beam ship the Pleiadians came in. This sort of thinking has led the Pleiadians to having no trust of our officials, thereby making any sort of commerce with us almost impossible. It is estimated that it may be around 300 years before any kind of social contact may be possible with us, due to the enormous gap in our spiritual and moral understandings. It simply isn't in their interest. Open contact. The Pleiadians are still here on Earth and occasionally visit Billy and others whom they are interested in, but we have not reached a time of public awareness and open contact as a society. It's very exciting to think that this may be a possibility within a few years. For me, and for many of you, the ability to go and visit a civilization on another planet is a very exciting idea. To visit another world and see how they live would be a dream come true. Being exposed to so many new ideas, experiences, and so much knowledge would probably be overwhelming. It would certainly be hard to return to Earth after experiencing the consciousness of a higher developed society. When this does happen and some of us get to visit the Pleiades and return to tell of our experiences like Billy did, the Earth will forever change and leave behind its adolescence. The paradigms that hold our society together will vanish and be replaced with new concepts and ideas that will leave a great mark in history. Over a two-year period, Simjace allowed Billy to take hundreds of photos of her spacecraft. She did this purposely as a method of proof to awaken the minds of Earthmen to the idea that they are not alone. Over the years, millions of people have looked at Billy's beautiful pictures and felt something stir inside of them. To some people, it brings on feelings of familiarity or just the excitement of knowing someone is out there. In any case, there is no question that Simjace's decision to let her ship be photographed has gone a long way in opening up the minds of many people on Earth. Silvano sees a ship. Since Billy had been allowed to take photos of the Pleiadian beamships, I was curious if any of the other FIGU members had ever taken any. Billy had over 1,000 pictures that he shot over a two-year period. It seemed likely that some of the others around the center might have had an opportunity to take some also. I spent most of my mornings helping out around the farm. It was great exercise and gave me a chance to somewhat earn my keep. The work around the center was organized by a fellow named Silvano. He was a young man who had brought his wife and baby to the center to learn about Billy's contacts. He had decided to stay on for a while to learn what he could, working the farm in exchange for his room and board. I had spent a lot of time with Silvano over the past few weeks and, of course, we had spent many hours discussing the Pleiadian material. Silvano was a very kind and friendly person. He had a big smile and open face that let you know immediately that you were welcome in his life. His sensitive nature and his inquisitive mind had led him to Billy to discover what he could about the messages from the stars. In this respect, we had a lot in common. I asked him if he had ever taken any pictures of the Pleiadian beamships, and he remarked that he hadn't. He had seen them, but didn't have a camera with him at the time. It had happened on a clear, sunny afternoon, just as he had finished some of his chores and was cleaning up in the kitchen. He was washing his hands in the sink and glanced out of the window that offered a view of the large valley that spread out next to the center. At first he thought the light was playing tricks on his eyes, because a flash of silver was dancing in the sunlight about a mile away. Catching his attention, the silver flash began to move slowly across the valley as he closely watched through the window. Silvano quickly moved from the sink and out the back door to get a better look. The silver object had moved in closer, and he could clearly make it out. It was a round, silver beamship, just like the ones in the photos Billy had taken. It suddenly changed directions a couple of times as it quietly flew over the trees. Then with a quick move it came closer, stopped, and hovered in the air. It was gently rocking like a boat in the water, an action that Billy had described several times himself. Then without making a sound, it suddenly just blinked out of sight and disappeared. Silvano was just left standing there with a big smile on his face. He had been at the center for over a year, and now he had seen real proof of the existence of the Pleiadian beamships. A birthday party. I had become pretty good friends with a lady named Bruni, who was kind enough to spend many of her evenings with me answering all of my questions. She had moved to Switzerland from Germany with her son to also learn from Billy. I told her about some of the experiences that Silvano had, seeing the Pleiadian beamships, and wondered if Bruni had seen them as well. She remarked that she had seen them on several occasions, but remembered her first experience more vividly than the others. It was on February 3, 1984, Billy's birthday. Bruni had just become a member of the FIGU, and had only been at the center for a couple of weeks. Since she had a son and a job in a neighboring city, she had taken an apartment in the nearby town of Wyla in order to be close to the center and her work. In honor of Billy's birthday, she had gone to the center to have dinner with the rest of the group. They were all sitting around the kitchen table when all of a sudden Billy straightened up in his chair, his soft blue eyes becoming brighter, as if something was happening to him. Bruni couldn't help notice the change and was just staring at him. Someone mentioned that this was common when he was receiving a telepathic message from the Pleiadians. Apparently, he was about to have a contact. Poppy, Billy's wife, had gotten him his coat. After all, it was wintertime and very cold in Switzerland. As soon as Billy was dressed, he walked to the back door of the kitchen, adjusted his coat, and walked out the door. Bruni was naturally very excited by all this and rushed over to the window to see what was going on. By the time she reached the window, Billy was nowhere in sight. He had vanished without leaving a footstep in the snow. Bruni was very excited but was soon calmed by the others, who had become accustomed to this sort of thing. It was only a few minutes later when suddenly Billy reappeared from the living room. He didn't appear cold, his jacket was undone, and there was no snow on his boots. Billy informed everyone that he had been gone for a couple of hours. It seems that Simjace had come to see him on his birthday. Even though he had been in the ship with her for a couple of hours, she had shifted time and returned him about 10 minutes after he left so as to not to spoil the family party in the kitchen. Bruni was quite excited to have witnessed this event, which cleared any doubts she may have had about Billy's experiences. Bruni said that she often sees the Pleiadian beam ships in the sky around the center. It is not uncommon to see them late at night, simply flying by as if to say hello. Since I seemed so interested, she produced a photo album that contained many photos of the alien crafts. These had all been taken by Billy on different occasions. The intriguing part was that many of these photos have not been seen before by the public. One fascinating photo was of a beam ship that Bruni called the Wedding Cake Ship. It was a new experimental design with some kind of round metal balls all over it. It did look a little like a wedding cake. I had seen one picture of this ship in America, but here were over a dozen photos of this strange craft in trees, over vans, and on the ground in front of the farmhouse. One special picture that caught my eye had been taken right over the van that I was living in behind the main house at the center. Another shot that fascinated me had been taken of the ship as it was hovering a few feet off the ground among many trees. The size of the ship was obvious in comparison to the surrounding trees. It also looked very alien compared to the normal saucer-like ships. Bruni explained that the Pleiadians allowed Billy to take pictures of the older saucer-like ships, since that image was more comfortable to most of us and would not cause as much fear. The next day at the center, I saw Billy and asked if I could get copies of some of the photos for myself. He was happy to oblige and suggested that I look through all of the photo albums. There were around 1,100 photos in very large albums. They were all numbered, so I could easily identify which ones I wanted. I picked out about a dozen that caught my eye, and later that afternoon Poppy gave me the copies. I think that was the day that I started staring at the sky a lot. I had a camera with me and became a little excited about the idea of capturing a photo myself. I realized that it had been several years since the physical contacts had stopped, but if they still came by for an occasional hello, perhaps I could get it on film. I asked Billy if he knew when they might be coming by, for I would very much like to see one for myself. He just smiled and nodded his head. The Pleiadian beamships. On Earth, when we see a strange object in our skies, we call it a UFO or flying saucer. UFO stands for unidentified flying object, but we may have to coin a new phrase now that we are in contact with the Pleiadians and know where they come from. Perhaps we could call them EFOs, for identified flying object. The Pleiadians, however, call their small ships beamships. The name comes from one of the first drive systems they developed, which relied on a light-emitting device to create power, hence the name beamship. The ships are equipped with two drive systems, one for speeds up to the speed of light and another for beyond the light barrier. A beamship is a small spacecraft capable of carrying three passengers from one place in the galaxy to another. It is a very common way to travel for the citizens of the Pleiades. Many different sizes and shapes are made, depending on the intended use. The saucer shape that is often seen on Earth is used on planets where there is an atmosphere or water. Giant ships of unusual shapes are also used to house and transport large numbers of Pleiadians in open space. The Pleiadians allowed photographs of the beamships to be made purposely. They are aware that a great number of people on Earth have lived previous lives where the beamship technology was used. Because of this, when we see the photos, most of us will not be afraid. For many people, the sight of the beamship may actually seem familiar and jar some old memories. At any rate, the design of the ship will seem non-threatening and comfortable to most of us, and provide a level of proof that life on other worlds does exist. Beamships are 7 meters, 21 feet, in diameter, carrying a crew of 3 and have interplanetary capabilities. They are most commonly used for short trips around planetary systems because of their small interior. If longer trips are required or more passengers need to be transported, then large ships that are more comfortable are used. The beamships weigh only 1.5 tons and do not have time travel capabilities, like some of their other designs. The engines use an implosion type of system, rather than explosion, causing matter to be converted back into something useful. The energy of the ship goes out the bottom of the ship and is reclaimed at the top. As it moves around the ship, it seems to distort all that is around it, causing the trees and all the surroundings to bend and distort. The field of energy around the ship causes the bottom to appear blue in color. Some of the distortion is caused by the energy screens that are projected by the ship for protection. Beam ships are used like we use cars. They are usually made for the individual and are connected to their thinking through organic intelligence. Pictures of the ship are only possible when they allow it, for the screens of the ships can also control the line of vision. In many of the photos, the beam ship was over a house or small community while the pictures were being taken, but no one could see the craft. The antennae guide beam on top of the ship is used to detect different kinds of energy. As an example, on one occasion the Pleiadians asked for some photos that had been taken of the ship, which included the antennae on top of the craft. They wanted the negatives and the camera for a while because they wanted to see how sensitive the film was to picking up the energies. An examination of the film by the Pleiadians revealed the energies from Saturn around the antennae as they had suspected. Billy was told that these energies would have an effect on our thoughts, causing many people on Earth to be grumpy or moody for the next few months. This strange energy would also cause the magnetic energy created by the ship's drive systems to be visible to the naked eye for the same period. The inside of the ship has three seats that fold out into sleeping couches. Most of the console of the ship is filled with different kinds of screens for obtaining information. There is a greenish-yellow light inside the ship that is generated by the windows, and they appear orange on the outside. Those windows are intelligent and control the ability to leave the ship. If the atmosphere outside is hostile, the windows will sense it and not allow the pit of the ship to open without the person wearing protective clothing. As the ship leaves the atmosphere, the color of the windows becomes clear. The shape of the ship is designed for the least resistance in an atmosphere and provides the largest surface area to enable the drive system to be the most effective. The ships are protected by an energy force field that allows the atmosphere to glide away instead of pushing against it. This protection field must be designed in such a way that it gives a little so as to not create resistance, or else it will slow down the ship, keeping it from reaching the speeds it must attain for travel. The protection field also neutralizes the attractive force of our planet. They are, in a sense, diverting gravity. The ship then acts as a planet itself, with its own gravitational force. The clothing that they wear can create the same effect as the protection girdle on the ships. They are worn outside the ship when on hostile planets. There is no feeling of movement inside the ship when it is flying, for it creates its own specific gravity and protects the inhabitants from any outside forces. Even when the ship is making sharp turns at tremendous speeds, there is no awareness of movement. There are many different types of information screens built into the consoles of the ship. They can be used for information about flight, planes, and life forms. The screens can be telepathically controlled like many of the functions of the ship and can display important information about any kind of life form, such as the time of birth and the expected length of an individual's lifespan. It can also be used to interpret the thoughts and feelings of an individual. The trip from Era, the Pleiadian home planet, takes 7 hours to reach Earth. They feel this is a long time to travel in a small ship. The total distance from Era to Earth is around 500 light years, which is a considerable distance. Here on Earth, we are used to measuring things in miles. For instance, it is approximately 400 miles from Los Angeles to San Francisco by car. If we drove that distance, it would take us about 7 hours, traveling at a speed of 55 miles per hour. This is the same amount of time it takes a beam ship to travel 500 light years from the Pleiades. We can envision the distance from Los Angeles to San Francisco since it is familiar to most of us, but a light year, how far is that? Light travels at the speed of 186,000 miles in 1 second, not an hour. That means that if we multiply the speed of light times 60, we get 11,160,000 miles in a minute. And then multiply by another 60, and we get 669,600,000 miles in an hour. A light year is the distance that light will travel in 1 year's time, which is 5,865,696,000 miles. That's 5,865,696,000,000 miles. That's so fast that our minds have nothing to relate it to. Here's an example that may help. It is approximately 24,000 miles around the Earth. If we used a flashlight as a light source and shined it due east, the light would travel around the Earth 7.75 times in 1 second. The light from the sun takes 8.3 minutes to travel 93 million miles to Earth before it hits our eyes. Even if we could travel at the speed of light in a beamship, theoretically it would still take us 500 years to get to the Pleiades. How then, are they able to get here in only 7 hours? The answer lies in the fact that beamships do not fly at the speed of light, but have the technology to convert themselves into fine matter particles that can travel faster than the speed of light. This is possible by traveling through what is called hyperspace, thereby making it possible to travel billions of miles in just part of a second. In order to understand this, a brief explanation of time and space is necessary, which will make all of this clearer. You and I live in a three-dimensional world of planets, suns, and galaxies. It is a material place that we can see and touch. The Pleiadians call it the coarse matter world since it is material and appears solid. Time is energy. It cannot be seen, but it is energy that causes the rotation and movement of the three-dimensional world we live in. It is a wave of pulse energy that moves through all matter, causing rotation, movement, and pulsation. Time controls the normal speed of all matter until something comes along and changes it. Time is considered fine matter since it is not solid and exists only in an energy form. Without time, space would stop moving. So we live in a space that is affected by the energy of time. The space we live in is comprised of different kinds of matter, carbon, hydrogen, zinc, and the other elements that make up all of the matter in our three-dimensional space. But the universe has other dimensions that do not contain the same matter as the three-dimensional part we live in. Hyperspace is one of these areas. Here, there are different kinds of energy particles that are moving at much higher speeds because time is different, and time does not exist in hyperspace the same as it does in our dimensions. The beamships have the technology to move themselves into hyperspace and convert themselves into high-speed particles that exist there. They then can travel much faster, going billions of miles in a part of a second. Once they arrive at their destination, they then re-enter normal space and convert themselves back into their original form. The time in hyperspace seems instantaneous, and the passengers will have no awareness of what has happened. Let's say we have borrowed a beamship and have decided to travel to the Pleiades. We don't know how to fly it, so we follow a manual of instructions to guide us through the procedure. We leave Earth at 12 o'clock noon for the Pleiades and begin to fly out of our solar system. The manual tells us how to set the proper coordinates, so we are going in the right direction. We begin to travel at several million miles per hour and are gaining speed as we go. As we speed up, we begin to feel sick, something is wrong, so we refer to the manual. It says that we are suffering from the effects of the mass-speed correlation. What is that, and how do we solve it? The problem is that as we accelerate in speed, our bodies are increasing in mass and we are becoming dysfunctional. If this continues, we will die. If you are in a car traveling down the highway and put your hand out the window, you can feel the resistance of the wind, can't you? Air is very powerful, indeed. If you go fast enough, you can catch enough of it with a wing to fly through the air in an airplane. In other words, air is slowly developing into a mass of resistance. In space there is no air, but there is mass. When you go fast enough, the mass of space will build up just like the wind, and you have resistance. If you continue to go even faster, the mass builds up around your body and crushes you. So the mass-speed correlation means that as we increase in speed, there is a buildup of mass that will destroy us and the ship if we continue. So how do we protect ourselves? The manual says to turn on the protective energy screens that surround the beamship, and we will be protected from the mass-speed correlation. These energy screens surround the beamship and isolate the ship from the mass of space. This bubble will also protect us from any debris we may run into in space. Energy screens also form artificial gravity, so now we are traveling in a beamship which is surrounded by a protective field of energy that creates gravity. Inside of the ship we have created a mini world with our own specific gravitational field, so we are separated from any force of energy outside of the ship. This enables our craft to make any changes in course, and we will have no feeling of it. We are only aware of the gravitational field inside of the ship. We are protected from the mass of space. It feels just like being on the ground, with no sensation of movement. Now that the screens have been turned on, we are feeling better and continue the trip. Soon we notice that we are traveling almost the speed of light. We will soon make the change into hyperspace and reappear in the Pleiades. The manual says we must wait until we are 153,000,001 kilometers, 94 million miles, past the last planet's orbit in our solar system before making the move into hyperspace. This is a safety precaution since the changeover into hyperspace creates a rip, or small tear, in time and can sometimes pull objects other than the beam ship in with it. It is also possible to cause a disturbance in the orbit of planets if we are too close. Zero-hour instruments tell us that we are approaching the safety distance, so we can get ready to make the move into hyperspace. We have been traveling for 3.5 hours. The time is 3:30 on our watches. Fortunately for us, it says in the manual that the process of moving into hyperspace is automated, so there is nothing for us to do. It even mentions that we won't feel anything during the change. As the ship approaches light speed, we can tell by our instruments that the screens are holding back tremendous energy. If they should fail, we would be crushed instantly from the incredible mass pressing against our protective energy screens. It takes tremendous amount of energy for the solid matter of the ship and its passengers to be converted into fine matter that can move in hyperspace. The Pleiadians have developed a technology that uses the tremendous pressure of the mass of space that is pressing in on us as a force to make the conversion. The first step in moving the beam ship into hyperspace is to turn off the protective screens, which immediately causes an enlargement of the mass. The tremendous energy that is rushing in on the ship is used to facilitate the changing of the matter of the beam ship into fine matter energy. We are no longer in our material form but have been converted, along with the ship, into a different form of energy that can exist in another dimension, which is called hyperspace. We have created a distortion of time and dematerialize ourselves. At the exact moment that we are converted, we must make the move into hyperspace, for if we don't, there will be a catastrophe. We have just been converted into particles of fine matter energy that exist in hyperspace, but we are still in our normal three-dimensional world. In order to make the move into hyperspace, a dilation of time is caused. The theory of relativity goes only to a certain point here. At the exact moment of the dilation of time, the breaking open of hyperspace occurs and the ship and crew, in their new form, move into hyperspace, also called null time. In hyperspace we are moving so fast that we appear paralyzed relative to the normal world. We can cross the 500 light years of distance to the Pleiades in a millionth of a second. The wonderful technology of the Pleiadians understands how to guide us in hyperspace and how to return us to the normal three-dimensional world at the right location. This is done by reversing the process that put us in hyperspace, causing us to leave this null-time dimension and causing a dilation in time again, whereby we are reformed back into our normal state. Within a millionth of a second we find ourselves outside of the Pleiadian solar system by a safe distance of 153 million kilometers. Or 94 million miles. A glance at our watch shows it is still 3:30. Our time in hyperspace was so short that we were not aware of any time passing. The whole process takes no more than a millionth part of a second. To our surprise, we didn't feel anything. We were out of our bodies for part of a second, though. We were not in material form but were, indeed, in an energy state while in hyperspace. It happened so fast that our material bodies didn't even remember being gone. It will now take us another 3.5 hours to fly into the solar system of Tegeta and land on the planet Era in the Pleiades. When we get there, it will be 7 o'clock on our watches, for we will have taken 7 hours to get there. Thanks to the technology of the Pleiadians, everything went well and we made it safely to our destination. Things don't always go well, though, as this is very difficult technology to understand and even harder to put into use. While we were in hyperspace, we could have slipped in time and been lost forever. This is caused by the change in speed of our fine matter energy particles while in hyperspace. If the speed of our fine matter energy form had accelerated relative to the flow of time in hyperspace, we would have slipped millions of years into the future. If our speed had retarded, we would have fallen back into the past. A single second in the hyperspace equals millions of years in normal space. This means that if our speed had not remained constant for the part of a second that we were in hyperspace, we would have returned to our normal space and would have been millions or even billions of years out of time. It is possible to remain in hyperspace for longer periods of time to cross greater distances, but the technology to control the speed while in the fine matter state is critical. Most races experience difficulty with this process, including many of our forefathers who have had to fight these same problems and are now lost in time forever. Many time travelers are stuck here on Earth. The dangers of speed are great, and their effects occur at even a few miles per hour. Even in our airplanes, we are increasing mass and dissolving matter, but because of the slow speed, the effects take a long time, possibly hundreds of years. At high speeds, it is reduced to decades or even a few years. As the speed increases, the danger of our thought patterns being damaged increases. This is the end of Part 8. For more information about the Pleiadian mission, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Again, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Also, subscribe and share this video. Let the whole world know the truth. Thank you for listening. Remember that knowledge is power. Please, don't be left in the dark. Please continue to Part 9 in the next video.